I'd like to add to that, Commissioner. In August and September, when we issued the confirmatory action letter and moved the plant to Column 4, we consciously kept the flooding issues and actions for plant restart separate from the ROP performance assessment process. They were not linked at that time. But once we became to understand the June 7th fire as a significant operational event, we actually asked ourselves the same question you just asked us, you know, does it meet this and how does it meet it? And are we being true to the criterion? And if the plant had been operating and that event had occurred, then we would have wound up in the same position.
Okay.
It would have resulted in a plant shutdown, a significant operational event, and transient. And so we would have taken us to the same path. And so, yes, I hope that helps give you some insight.
That is helpful. I appreciate both of the commentary, the comments that you both made in response to that question. And, Elmo, I think you did a good job in response to my first question of talking about how the 0350 process, because we can design what we need there in terms of an inspection process, we need some aspect, again, of our oversight not to be so regimented that you do need, in my view, something like an 0350, because you're always going to find yourself in unique circumstance, plant specific, that we need to have aspects of our program that allow us to do to design something that fits for the circumstances, and that's some of how 0350 at the time was explained to me by Eric Leeds and others. And you're nodding your head to that. I think that was a point you emphasized earlier in response to that. So I think the other question that, you know, we have many performance indicators, and when I went to our website and looked at a lot of the different areas of performance, it did look like, you know, things were green, but there were some areas where the trends were downward in some areas, and the findings that we had were of various levels of safety significance. So it sounds like in light of that, coupled with the extreme flooding event, 0350 just made a lot of sense to you.
Well, I think that's correct. Being in column four with a significant operational event speaks to significant performance issues that warranted the additional verification prior to plant restart, and 0350 gives us a process to accommodate that.
And my last question is, my other understanding is that an aspect of, if plants are shut down for whatever reason for extended periods, we don't have the inputs to populate the ROP indicators. How do we go about regaining that? I know, as Bill Borchardt emphasized, we're early stages of this process, but how do you go about at the point where we're convinced that restart is appropriate? How do they move out of this and back into the ROP?
Good. That is one of the assignments of the 0350 oversight panel, is develop that transition plan. I'll let Troy address some of the details.
Well, a lot of that hinges on what's in the plan issue list and the restart checklist. So through our review of the facility's comprehensive assessment, we'll come in with a fairly large team, do a validation of that assessment. From that, we'll develop the additional items to fill out the restart checklist or the plant issues list. And we'll work to those, and we'll go back and do additional validation inspections to make sure each of those items has been resolved to ensure safe restart of the facility. And then once we're confident that we can do that, in that decision, we'll develop an inspection plan to go through restart, post-restart, and we'll go in and we'll brief ELMO. We'll make a recommendation that we believe the facility is safe for restart, and then ELMO, in consultation with NRR, will sign off on that.
Okay, it looks like we'll be hearing more about that in the future. Yes, John.
One point is in 0350 is it allows us, and is designed that way, that we would continue under the 0350 process even after restart for some period of time, so that we could address your specific issue there, so that we can understand that the performance is sustained performance moving forward, and we can look at a couple months, and that will be determined by the restart panel, how long that would be of performance indicator data to determine what would be the best place to put them back into the action matrix.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This column five, is that a recent addition to the ROP? And I noticed that some of you even skipped it. You said from 4 we went to 0350. So was it last Monday or a year ago? When was it added? It wasn't there at the beginning. Column 5.
It wasn't recently added to the action matrix, and that,
as we talked, the exact time frame of that.
Fred Brown's going to give you the exact time frame, but as he's coming up, as we talked about it, the entry condition, even in 0350, specifically says if a plan is in column 4 or column 5, we can transition to 0350. So the process is designed such that it's an enhanced oversight process customized to the condition of the plan based on performance issues and the current plan issues. Current the time.
Yeah, this is Fred Brown, NRR. Column 5 was an original part of the SECI 0907 formulation for the reactor oversight process. The change that was made to the ROP and the management directive about 5 years ago was to specifically add 0350 and how the 0350 process interrelated with column 4 and column 5. But the original ROP did have 5 columns. And the unacceptable performance, I believe, was in.
So a plant can be in column 5 without going to 0350?
No, if a plant goes to column 5, we handle it in 0350.
Okay. So it's automatic then?
Yes.
You have to go to 0350. You mentioned that there were multiple degraded, repetitive degraded cornerstones. I wonder how the plant reached that state. I mean, I thought part of the agencies adopting the ROP is that there would be early warning that things are not going well. And yet, we end up with a plant that has multiple repetitive degraded cornerstones, and then we move on to 0350. Does that mean that we don't have enough leading indicators in the ROP to warn us so that we'll never reach that level, or what does it mean?
That's a question we're going to ask ourselves and we're going to have to answer. We have the same question. I'll just, and so that's going to be part of the process is to take a look, lessons learned on the regulatory aspects of this historically. But I'll give you my personal assessment. The site had a degraded cornerstone in 2007-2008, and we completed the supplemental inspection and gave it an upcheck. Here we set 2010 another degraded cornerstone, same cornerstone, and so for the same cornerstone to become degraded over the course of 3 or 4 years, that's probably. In the big picture, that's telling you something about organizational performance. And the reactor oversight process doesn't carve that out separately for consideration. But looking back on it historically, that was an indicator to us is that cornerstone degraded again and doesn't register in the action matrix, but it's a historical fact that I think we'll have to give consideration. And this time, we saw additional findings of significance on top of that and the significant operational event. And that's what led us up to today.
Yeah, you know, every couple of years we start talking about leading indicators and we don't have one, never have had one. I hope someday we will, but it's not on the horizon. So it's a challenge, but this is a rare and unusual event. It hasn't happened in 10 years. It's far more often that a plant goes to column 2, maybe goes to column 3, addresses the issues, and ends up ultimately back up in column 1. So that's by far the more normal path.
But there will be some reevaluation of the ROP after the...
Well, we do that annually. I mean, this will certainly be a major part of the annual assessment to figure out the sequence of events that led to this exact situation.
And as an input to that, as part of our process plan for the oversight panel, we will be looking at the lessons learned of the way we've implemented this and looking back at the record to provide information on our annual reassessments of the reactor oversight process.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Pruitt, you said that among other things, the panel that you're chairing will have to decide that the safety culture is good. There will be a survey and before you give the go-ahead. How do you decide that?
As part of the process, Fort Calhoun's required to complete an independent safety culture assessment, so they've let out a contract with an outfit to come in and perform that review for them. are the human factors group in NRR will validate the process, the survey tools, and the types of questions that that group will use at the facility, and then our inspection follow-up team will go in and look at those results from that team. We'll compare those to our results that we obtained through the inspection, and to the extent that there's alignment between what they found and what we found.
But presumably, there are two cultures here. One is before they enter O350, and the other will be afterwards. I mean, there will be some changes. So which culture are you looking at, the one after?
We'll want to get a perspective on the historical safety culture to make sure that the corrective actions that they took were appropriate to get the behavioral changes that they wanted at the facility. And we'll also take a snapshot at the current day safety culture as well. A lot of times in the focus group sessions, the people that sit there around the table, once you have a conversation with them, they'll talk about, here's how things were at the facility, here's the meaningful changes that we've seen as we've developed aspects of our integrated improvement plan. So
we still don't know what a good safety culture is, though, do we? I mean, that will be your judgment that, yeah, they're okay
right
now.
Right.
Well, okay. And then you say they will return to the reactor oversight process. They will return to which column? All green?
The oversight panel.
They will return to the process itself.
Yeah, the oversight panel. Right. Yeah, the oversight panel will make a recommendation as to which column to place Fort Calhoun Station back into. It'd be speculative right now, but I believe the recommendation that the panel would come forward with eventually would be, we're going to have a confirmatory action letter that's open. Traditionally, with the 95003 plant that's in column four, they would remain in column four until completion of the confirmatory action letter, and then they would transition back into column one or two, or whatever the findings supported at that time.
So they would return to column four?
Possibly.
Pretty serious.
Right, possibly, right.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Magler.
Thank you, and good morning. First, let me say that I appreciate Elmo and Troy and the Region 4 staff and the work they put into this, as well as the NRR staff. This is something I know you've been following for a long time, and Elmo and I have talked about this on multiple occasions, and I appreciate the amount of work that's gone into preparing for this stage and the amount of work that's going to go forward in seeing this through. I wanted to ask a couple of historic questions first, just to get some orientation, and hopefully and Elmo, you look old enough to have been around long enough, so maybe you can answer some of these questions. But as I look back, we really haven't had plants in O350 very many times. It's been less than a dozen times in the history of the agency. Maybe you've looked at this as you've gone into this process, but I'm curious as to whether O350 is most often activated by a particularly large operational problem of a well-defined nature, or is it generally lots of operational problems in lots of different areas? When you look back, is there a pattern that you see where the plants end up in O350? And Bill, feel free to chime in.
Yeah.
I'll start, and then my boss will follow up. My recollection is usually there's some acute occurrence that was of such significance and spoke to the facility performance that really became the seed or the catalyst to really prompt us to seriously consider O350. And that's similar to what happened here. It was the fire on June 7th that affected both trains of safety-related equipment that really had risk significance and safety significance. So.
Yeah, I'd say, you know, the vast majority, almost 10 of the issues, preceded ROP. Mm-hmm. So this was back in the days of SALP and some of the words that have been banished from the regulatory dictionary. At least half of them, I would say, just based on my general recollection, were just long-term, sustained, nagging issues that the regional staff and the had developed numerous inspection findings. We didn't have the rigorous methodology that the ROP affords us, so it was kind of more of a lingering issue of problems not being fixed that at least on half of the occasions led to entry into 0350.